inviting me. So what I'm going to do is I'll walk you through two, three kinds of things. One is I'll walk you through, you know, the philosophy of AI as I have understood after practicing it for the last 20 years, and a template of AI thinking, which is how do we adopt AI into our businesses and all that. Yeah. So, you know, if you look at technology by itself, technology has been a journey for human civilization. And really, if I want to summarize what it is nothing but a way to extend what we do into machines, right? So if we cannot lift heavy things, we created cranes. If we cannot run very fast, we created cars. And it's the same extension of technology, which is intelligence, which is if we cannot, you know, process petabytes of data, we created cloud computers. If we cannot make very intelligent decisions, we used you know, AI, right? So the idea of technology is extended to AI in the same sense that how do we make machines do the same kinds of things like thinking, learning, understanding, creativity, and how do we extend these capabilities to the cloud and not be limited by individual brain sizes, right? So if you look at technology, you know, all aspects of technology are evolving, right? So if you look at tools, computing, interfaces, you know, the idea of data, the idea of intelligence, all of that is evolving. And also what is the idea of a product is evolving, and therefore the idea of what is AI is should also be evolving, right? So I'm going to walk you through some of that journey, right? So if you look at tools, you know, since the birth of mankind, we've been inventing tools to do things better and faster, right? So, you know, the cavemen invented tools, we invented tools, and you know, now we have tools that can manufacture cars, right? So the era of the tools, if you will, has been going on. The idea of sensors has been evolving, right? If you look at the world that we live in today, it's full of sensors, right? And you know, let's take this as a sensor, and then you know, that sensor evolved, and now we can send a telescope all the way to the end of the universe, right? So sensor technology has been evolving, and you know, if you look at the medical world, the genetics world, the you know, remote sensing world, the cars have many sensors, the phone have many sensors. So this idea of sensor is very important, and now that we can sense the world around us well, we can do something more intelligent with it, right? So the sensors have been evolving. Computing obviously has been evolving, right? And there's new computing coming on the horizon, quantum and all of that. The idea of data has been evolving, right? When we were young, we used to think of data as an Excel spreadsheet with rows and columns, but now data is, you know, a lot of different types of data all over the place. So the type of data, the volume, and all of that is evolving. And you know, with the birth of the internet and with the birth of the IoT, this idea of data will continue to evolve. Yeah? So all these things are evolving. The idea of what is an interface is also evolving, right? So when we talk to each other, we talk very naturally using language and speech and gestures and emotions. But when we talk to machines, we still talk in a very UI-heavy, menu-driven system. So this is one interface. And now imagine I could just have a conversation and say I need a cab and everything the machine knows, you know, and you know, who wants to type? What if I could just speak into the system? So the idea of what is an interface between human and machine is also evolving, right? So we see these evolutions going on, and now we are ready to start to talk about AI as part of this overall evolution. Yeah? So AI, in my mind, is more than just a collection of tools and technologies. It's really you know, a way of thinking. And if we understand the way of thinking, then we can really adopt it very easily. Yeah? So if you look at a lot of large companies, small companies, countries, and civilizations, they're going through these four stages of transformation, right? So there is an infrastructure stage where you build up the basic infrastructure, right? So if I want to start an Ola cab, I you know, create the app, I create the driver app, customer app, I onboard drivers and customers, so that is infrastructure. Then we realize I cannot scale without automation, we go through the automation revolution. And now we are collecting a lot of data. Because we have done automation, we have scale, we are now logging everything. And you know, the early use cases of logging were really about, can I just debug if there is a problem, or can I report the summaries of what is going on in my system? So that was the first set of use cases of why we were collecting data. But then we realized that we can actually use data to improve upon the automation that I have created, right? And that is the birth of AI. So AI thinking is really about, hey, you know, you go through this linear process, but then you realize, oh, what I've done with the data, now I need to go back and use it for something better. Yeah? And that's when a lot of companies are making a data to AI transformation. Yeah? So whether you look at Google or Reliance or Ola or Swiggy or India, we are making the same transition, right? And it doesn't matter what kind of products we build, we are going to eventually become an AI-first product. It may look like, you know, Paytm is a wallet that helps you make money or transfer money, but really, as an infrastructure, they started, and now Paytm will also become an AI company. Yeah? So there's no such thing as, you know, this service or that service. And once we understand this concept, then, you know, it'll be very easy to think about that journey in a different way. Yeah? Now, there's a lot of, you know, buzzwords out there, and I just wanted to give a sense of the four buzzwords that, you know, I think are interesting to look at. Within AI journey, people have the four stages, right? So the first stage is, can I report what has already happened? Yeah? So I can look at my past in so many ways and say, you know, this happened, that happened. But now some human has to still look at all the reports and come up with insights and then make the next set of decisions, right? So that is the BI level of AI. Yeah? Then we said, no, we don't want to just look at the past. Can I actually predict the future? Is this customer about to churn? Is this, you know, the car about to stop in front of me, right? So I want to predict the future and then make my decisions and not have a human in the loop to make those decisions. Now, you know, this was the birth of a theoretical foundation of AI, which is all machine learning. But just predicting the future is also not enough, because if I could predict the future, but if I cannot affect the future, then it's useless to predict the future, right? So that is the birth of data science. So when we talk about data science is really a layer of actions on top of a layer of predictions, right? And you know, now we can make one decision better because I can predict and I can make that decision, right? So this car is about to break down, I can tell that, or this part is about to break down, or this person is about to break down, mentally, physically, medically. So we can do that with all the Fitbits and all the sensors in the cars and sensors in the plants. Now we can take actions on it, right? Before it happens. And the last thing that, you know, really what the promise of AI is not just these three, but really how do you make long-term strategic decisions as opposed to the immediate one decision at a time, right? And that's where the real power of AI will be seen. So if you look at, you know, agriculture, healthcare, education, these are not single decision processes. This is a sequence of decisions that must happen to get it right, right? Customer lifetime value is not a one decision. Should I give him a loan or not? It's a long-term decision on many things. So that's the real promise of AI. And in that sense, a lot of companies are not there yet, right? We are still struggling with, you know, BI, and some companies have reached the data science layer. All right. Now, if I have to explain what AI does in a business or in a system, really, it helps us make better decisions. So I'm just going to define what is a better decision. Yeah? So, you know, decisions were made earlier in a very broadcast way, right? Let me send these coupons to all my customers, right, on a Friday evening. Now, you can do a very personalized decision, right? This customer gets this coupon, this customer gets this coupon. And not just for coupons and all those, we can also now think about personalizing education, for example, right? One of the most broadcast decisions we make is all the kids in the country will study from the same textbook at the same pace, and that's a broadcast decision, right? And education is a highly personalized exercise, and we have been following a very wrong kind of an education system, right? So how do we make this kind of a thing? What about medicines? Can I create personalized medicines? Instead of the same aspirin to everybody for the same thing, you know, can we have different kind of treatments, right? So that is one thing that AI can do, help you transform your decisions from broadcast to personalized. Another thing that it does is batch to real time. See, if we are not able to do high compute, we can only do batch decision, right? Every Friday, some coupons will go out, right? 10th grade, there is some exam that will happen. So it's a batch decision, right? But now we can do very real-time decisions, right? So imagine, you know, you go buy a few products, you know, you buy a printer at the store, and instead of waiting for next month's coupons, I can immediately print out a coupon for your cartridges because I know that you just bought printer, you're going to need cartridges in a month or so, right? So how do we make decisions in a real-time fashion and not wait for a calendar event to happen, but a trigger event to happen? And this is a very big shift that has happened. So, you know, a lot of companies were doing these calendar-based stuff, right? Sale on a Diwali or whatever, right? But now, imagine if you missed a cab in Ola because the driver was sleeping at 3 a.m. Now that event has happened, now you can predict that the customer is very unhappy and you can take an action how to bring him back. Yeah? So this ability is now personalized and real time as opposed to batch and broadcast. Another thing AI can do is instead of reacting to stuff, we can now be very proactive about it. So if I can predict that a kid is about to fail, I can do something beforehand. If a farmer is about to have a bad crop, I can do something beforehand, right? If a plant is about to break down for some reason, I can do something beforehand. If a customer is about to churn, what can I do beforehand? So this ability to do proactive decision and not do retrospective analysis and root cause analysis and then correction, and the cost of that is very high, but the cost of this is very low, but you need a little bit of intelligence there. And the last thing AI can do is it can help us make not just tactical decisions, right? What kind of loan should I give him now? Versus a strategic decision, which is, how do I keep this customer happy for the long term? Yeah? So a lot of real life decisions, like what career moves you should make, are strategic decisions, right? Can AI help you there? What kind of food you should eat now or lifestyle is a strategic decision because it will have an impact on the long term health. So the Fitbits of the world can do that, right? So this idea of strategic decisions is very important. Today, if you look at agriculture, a lot of farmers say, I need this yield of this crop to be very high, so I'm going to use a lot of fertilizers and pesticides. What does it do to the long term, right? So the soil goes down in the long term, and long term suffers because of the short term. So that balance is what AI is also going to be able to do. Yeah? So these are the four things that AI does to help us make better decisions. Now, AI is also evolving. So the idea that, you know, today data can give us a lot of deep insight. It's not just something you store. You don't just have to talk to your phone. The phone actually understands what you're saying is that evolution, right? I don't just take a picture in my camera, but the camera can understand what the picture is, right? This ability that, you know, happens between the retina and the brain, for example, right? The collection of the data and the interpretation of the data is now very easy in many, many domains. And now we are ready to do something wonderful. Yeah? So we have created, you know, an AI which is like a four-year-old child right now. And now, obviously, that will continue to grow, right? Vision and speech and language and all these systems will continue to grow. But we are ready to now put them all together to build the next generation products. Yeah? And that is what we are ready to do now. So if I look at the idea of a product, and you know, what were the products that our parents, generation got excited about, right? So these are products that came with what we call programmed intelligence or instinctive intelligence, right? So when your iPad goes in a bright sun, it increases the brightness. It's a programmed intelligence, right? When your engine is in the car is bad, some light has to go on, is a programmed intelligence. So all these products came with programmed intelligence, like an animal comes with an instinctive intelligence, right? They didn't become better over time. They just got programmed with certain level of intelligence. Now, the next generation products after this that we got used to were very different from these products. And you know, if you want to take a stab, what were the next generation products that got us excited about? We don't get excited about cars anymore. But we get excited about some other things. As we grew up in the last 10 years, what are product 2.0, if you will?
Google Maps.
One of the most used, most important product the world has right now is Google Maps, yes. And it's very intelligent, right? And it can tell you and change the routes. If you miss something, it can again do it, and it does it for billions of people. I mean, it's just the most fascinating product. If there was one product that I had to pick from the entire set of products we have created, that's the one that just change the world for us, yeah? Okay?
WhatsApp.
Smartphones, WhatsApp, yeah? So all these are, you know, if I look at the Google search itself, right? It has become such an integral part that we don't even think of it as something different, right? So all these products, right? If you look at social networking and all of that, Now, what is a very special characteristic of these products? Yeah? These are very different from product 1.0, and these products taught us how to take one idea of search or connecting people or recommending something, take one machine learning idea and build a product at a planet scale, right? So in the last 20 years, we have learned the art of building gigantic planet scale products. And the quality of these products is they don't become intelligent if we don't use them, right? If people don't use Google Maps, they won't know where the reds and the oranges are. If people don't do clicks in Google search, search will not improve. If people don't take the recommendations of YouTube, YouTube will not become better, right? So what we have learned is that we all participate to make these products better by giving that feedback data. So this is what I call crowdsource intelligence, where lots of people use a product and with that feedback, the product improves. So that is the essence of an AI thinking, which is don't make an intelligent product on day one. Put all the hooks in it that will make it intelligent over a period of time. This difference in thinking is very important because IT people think that when I have created an IT product, it must work on day one. But an AI product must not work on day one. If it is working on day one, something is wrong. Yeah? Like babies don't start talking on day one, right? It takes a little bit of time. So intelligence has that nature. All right, what about product 3.0? What are the next set of products we are going to create? Automated cars, very nice. So we've heard of these, right? Drones and cars and this and that and virtual reality and all of that, right? So in my mind, the product 3.0 will be a collection of these plus these. It's a hybrid ecosystem where there will be physical things and there will be intelligence in them. So the distinction between products as physical things and cloud will come closer, right? So a connected car ecosystem, for example, where there is a physical car, there's a cloud, and these products are going to not just talk to people, like Google search is people to product relationship, but imagine these products are talking to each other also. So your car and the other guy's car on the cloud are talking and negotiating which road you should take, which road I should take, so that globally our commute is optimized. Now today what we do, we try to optimize each one's commute, and then we got messed up in all this traffic, right? Now imagine that kind of an intelligence, which is going to be what I call ecosystem intelligence, which will happen when products share knowledge and information and in the cloud, they make these smart decisions. So smart cities, connected cars, connected homes are the next generation products that will come up, yeah? And we are going to need to change our idea of intelligence, AI, to build such products. There are no such algorithms that currently can do this, so we need to think about how will that be, yeah? Now, another thing that a lot of AI people and a lot of data scientists struggle with is this idea of, we talked about the process thinking and the loop thinking, yeah? So this is how AI works, and when I say AI, I also talk about us as intelligent people, right? This is also how we also work, right? So imagine there is some reality out there, right? Now, all of us, through our life experiences, education, bringing up, school, all of that, we have sampled a very small sample of that reality, right? Depending on where we grew, what culture we followed, what friends we had, we all have a very small sample of the reality, and our brain has been picking that up since our birth, and that is the data I have, right? From that data, we have discovered knowledge. Oh, this is also a chair. Oh, that is a dog. Oh, this poodle is also a dog, right? So I'm constantly discovering knowledge, and I'm constantly refining knowledge. Oh, chair could be like this also, or dogs can be like this also, right? So this idea that I'm discovering and refining knowledge all the time from data is a very fundamental idea. So data by itself is useless if you're not able to do this, right? And we have a model now of what is a car, what is a dog, because we have been constantly doing this process. And now, when I generalize that knowledge and say, look, that bird flies, and this is also a bird, can it fly? That is generalization, right? And we generalize that knowledge, and that is our model of reality, yeah? Now, take this to Flipkart versus Amazon. The reality is the same market, right? Same set of customers, same set of products, same set of sellers. Reality is the same. Flipkart's view of reality is different because it has a different sample of the data. And Amazon's view of the same reality is different because they have a slightly different sample of the data. And they have, and if you can do this better, you can have a better model of reality if you do better AI. Yeah? And this is one cycle that is very important. The other very important cycle is when I actually look at the next data that comes, I can interpret that data better, not because I have a certain amount of knowledge that I have accumulated so far. And this we have seen all the time because if I look at, you know, let's say you read a book when you're 5 year old, you will interpret it in a one way. Now you take the same book and you read it 5 years later, why would you interpret it differently? It's the same data. The book is the same, but because I have a better knowledge about the world, I can now understand the jokes in the book. Earlier I was not, and that interpretation ability increases. Now this is what I call the AI loop. And this is very different from an IT thinking. Yeah? So let AI systems evolve and be patient with them like we are patient with any intelligent system, right? Another thing that you know I learned when I went from Google, Microsoft, Yahoo, like companies to Ola, I learned something very different and my AI thinking evolved, right? So earlier what I thought was that, you know, look, you know, Google has a search engine, it needs a search model. Google has an ads engine, it needs an ad model. Google has a spam problem on internet, so it'll have a spam model. So it became a collection of models, right? Similarly, banks, they will have a credit model, they'll have a market segmentation model, they'll have a churn model, they'll have all kinds of models, right? So what happened was that, you know, today these corporations have become a collection of models. Yeah? Some sitting in COBOL, some sitting in SAP, some sitting in Go, or some sitting in whatever. And now over the last so many years, we have become a collection of models, right? And these models work independently. They have their own silos of data, their own silos of decision, and they don't talk to each other. Yeah? That is the current state of AI in a lot of companies, including big companies like Google. Yeah? Now, when I went to Ola, I realized that, look, this is not going to work because a pricing guy in Ola will tell me that pricing is the most important problem and how do you solve that? Then you know somebody else from driver side will say, look, if you can onboard the right drivers at the right time, that is the best problem to solve. Then on the customer side, somebody said, how do you solve that problem, right? And so there were like 5-6 different PMs looking at the Ola problem as 5 things, different problems, right? And after spending 3 months with them, I realized that Ola is a single optimization problem, which is how do you match supply to demand at all times and locations? That's the single most simplest way to say what a two-sided marketplace does, right? Now, pricing is trying to solve that problem differently. Driver onboarding is solving that differently. Customer onboarding is solving that differently. They're all solving the same problem differently, and they're not in sync with each other. So you onboard more drivers, but now the customers are the same, right? So the problem is that what we needed was, we needed a way to jointly think of the overall problem and say, what is your final objective function? For that, how do you allocate a cab to a customer? Depends on whether the customer is this, that, or the other. So you have customer models, you have driver models, you have pricing models. Together, they get into the allocation model. So the models are now talking to each other. The output of models go as inputs to the other model. So this is what I call a new way of thinking about AI systems. And unless we start thinking like that, we are not going to create smart cities or connected cars. Right? Yeah. But let me quickly go through, there are a lot of different AI algorithms. So if you say, oh, I'm excited about AI, let's go to Google and say AI courses. And it tells you that there are 100,000 pages, and you have to learn like 500 things to get to be a data scientist, right? So I'll just quickly summarize all of that, and then tell you why we have so many algorithms, and what role do they play in the overall AI ecosystem, yeah? So we have algorithms that can summarize your customers, right? They can say these are this kind of customer, these are customers who buy these products, these are customers who buy that product. So you can do summarization in any domain, you can do summarization of your stuff. You can also do a lot of understanding. So now, today, machines can understand text very well. So if you have call center data, you have Twitter data, you can actually not just collect, you can understand what people are saying about your products and services. So you can understand words. So here we gave the machine a lot of text data to read from, you know, Yelp reviews, and then we asked the machine, what is the meaning of the word ambience? And it could actually figure out that these are the meanings of the word ambience. So there's no dictionary, and I can do this in any language now without having the machines to be trained, right? And so it can understand meanings of words and sentences, even if it is grammatically wrong or spelling wrong. If you have enough data, for machine, this is not English. For machine, this is not language. For machine, it's just a bunch of patterns. And the machines don't understand these words and sentences the way we do. We understand them because we have experienced ambience. Machines don't experience ambience. What they do, they collect the description of the word ambience from many, many people, and then they try to figure out what it means. So there's a different way, but the output is very similar. So we can also extract knowledge, right? So if you give me a piece of text, I can actually tell you that this is what you're really saying. And if I can convert a piece of text into what we call a knowledge graph, then I can do wonderful things. I can now answer questions on the knowledge graph, right? So this is another paradigm shift that is happening, that, you know, Google and all these companies are moving away from document thinking to knowledge graph thinking. That's a very big paradigm shift. You will see this, you know, Alexa and all these companies. You cannot answer a complex question with search. You can answer it by doing reasoning on a knowledge graph. So these are two different things. And, you know, FAQs and all of that can happen through creating knowledge graphs now. Yeah. Then, you know, we can interpret a lot of things now. We can interpret your sensor data, your speech, your images. So today machines can tell you this. Tomorrow they'll be able to tell you, what is the dog doing? What is the breed of the dog? What is the girl's age, right? What is her race? What is the floor type, right? So what is the brand of the chair? So the way we interpret images, it becomes better and better, deeper interpretation. So we'll get deeper interpretation of anything that we'll see, whether it is images or videos or text, we are going to be able to interpret it very deeply, right? So a tweet or a you know, a feedback is not just positive sentiment or a negative sentiment. It's really, if you deeply understand it, it is really about which entity we are talking, which aspect of that entity we are talking, and then do we like it or not. So in the same sentence, I can say the restaurant was great, food was spicy, but, you know, service was good, right? So I can have different sentiments on different aspects of different entities in the same one sentence, and that is the, you know, that is how beautiful languages are. So machines have to be able to understand and interpret language at that level. Yeah? We all understand there are prediction algorithms. So the input type doesn't matter. Whether you tell me whether it's a credit card transaction or a customer history, I can predict anything from it. If you tell me your sensor data on the phone, I can tell you what you are doing. If you tell me what is the sequence of API calls, I can tell you whether it's a hacker or a normal person, right? So prediction is now possible, and we have made a lot of progress. We can do recommendations all day long, right? And sometimes we almost don't like them anymore. But here is a, you know, and then we can also do reasoning, which is another class of algorithms, which is about long-term thinking, right? A sequence of actions completing a task, whether it's playing a game, solving a math problem, or building a chatbot. A lot of people think chatbot is an NLP problem. Chatbot is not an NLP problem, it's a reasoning problem. What do you say, then what do I say, then what do you say, then what do I say, is a sequence of actions, right? How I say it is a different thing. Which language do I say it is a different thing. But it's a sequence of actions. So these are all different paradigms of algorithms. And now we are wondering, you know, you have interpretation, semantics, reasoning, prediction, recommendation. What do I need in my business? How do I think about this buffet out there and pick and choose, and what will my plate look like, right? So now, let me kind of demystify this and say, look, AI also has a very systematic architecture of thinking, yeah? So all intelligent systems, including us, are what I call a stimulus response learning systems, yeah? So the idea of stimulus is very important. So the data that you collect all the time, you know, point of sale data, the Fitbit data, the sensor data is the stimulus data. So that is your stimulus data. And what do we do with the stimulus data? And this is the first creative process in AI, which is, how do I convert the stimulus data into a bunch of state numbers, right? So for example, if I look at your, you know, SMSs on all your financial transactions, there are like 1,000 startups now who, what they do, they look at your you know, SMS data and try to predict whether you are a disciplined financial person, whether you are a fraudulent person, what is your credit rating, what is your capacity. So let's say if I come up with these four scores for every person, that's a very semantic state of, you know, in which I have converted the raw data into those four numbers. Now imagine your stimulus data, right, your Fitbit. If I can convert that to a state vector and say, what is your cardiac health? What is your gastric health? What is your mental health? What is your emotional health, right? So imagine if I could do that. This process is one of the most interesting processes, right? If I have satellite data for the whole country, can I actually tell the state of every crop in every farm, the stage and the health of every crop? So this idea of how do you convert stimulus data into a state vector, yeah, is the first thing we do. And then based on that, we apply reasoning and we say, this is my goal. I want to maximize the yield. I want to stay healthy. I want to make sure the student is doing well. So I have converted this, and now I can take the appropriate action. And that action I will manifest through a process, through an app or a service or a coupon. And then I have a stimulus, I have a response. And now, up till now, this could have been done with an IT process also, right? I could have coded up or imagined what the state should be. I could have written rules that if you are in this state, do this, and I could see a stimulus. Up till now, this is the same as an IT system. What makes it an intelligent system is the fact that wherever we collect lots of such pairs of stimulus and responses and say, look, this was the, you know, patient who came, he showed these symptoms, I diagnosed him with this disease, I gave him this medicine, and he still died, or he didn't get well. Then the feedback is what makes us intelligent, right? So the next time something similar happens, I should do. That is the transition between, I know everything, therefore I know how to write this rule, versus I don't know, I'm still learning, so let me collect all the feedback and keep learning my system of analysis, which converts, maybe the stimulus to state was wrong, maybe I didn't diagnose the problem properly, or maybe I didn't take the action correctly, given that I diagnosed the problem properly, or maybe I didn't manifest my actions correctly. So all the three systems can be improved with the feedback. Now, why we are talking about this? All of your AI algorithms that you will ever study will only fall into either this category or this category. Yeah? So the idea is the whole of AI is now summarized in one slide. So there are algorithms that convert stimulus data to state, right? So when you understand speech or understand vision or understand, you know, say something to Alexa, what you're saying, what Alexa understands is this part of it. And then, you know, what action it takes, what answer it generates is the other part of it, right? And this is how we can summarize all of AI systems. And whether I'm building a refinery improvement or a traffic improvement or an Alexa improvement, I can think of this loop all the time, right? And now you can say, is this better? Let me improve this, let me improve this. If you improve both sides over a period of time, you'll have an intelligent system going. So now, what is the template of AI thinking? A lot of people say, you know what, I want to adopt AI, I built a startup, what do I do next, right? And there's a very simple template on how do you adopt AI into your businesses. So the first question is, what is the metric, right? So some people say, you know what, I am running this system and it's great. How do you know it's great? What are you measuring? So the first thing is, in any system, I want to define what are the metrics that are there. Then I ask the second question, what do you know? What is your domain knowledge? So refineries, for example, will have a lot of domain knowledge, the whole chemistry and the physics and the thermodynamics of it. So we have a lot of domain knowledge that we have used to build those systems, right? Then we say, okay, now what is your stimulus data you are collecting all the time? So then we say, look, in the refinery world, we are collecting all this sensor data, right? So stimulus data is a lot more, it keeps coming all the time, right? And then we say, okay, now tell me, how do you convert all your stimulus data, which is a lot, into a very small number of state vectors, right? So can you tell me the efficiency of every part of your plant? Can you tell me the potential that it will break down in the next one day for every part of your plant? So how do you build these models is the first creative process in AI. And you utilize the domain knowledge and the data to build these models. Yeah? And then you say, if the plant part is about to break down or if the efficiency is low, what do you do? So what are your controllers and actuators that you will do to automatically come in, you know, bring it back to normal? Right? This we do with our health all the time. You know, we have domain knowledge, we have metric, I want to be healthy and long life, I have stimulus data, we eat, we exercise or not, and then we have a state of our health. Based on the state, we react, you know, we rest or we sleep or we drink a lot of water, whatever, and then my metrics improve, right? So this cycle is very natural. There's no need for a PhD to understand this. And what we really need to understand in every domain, how do I apply this cycle, right? So in the retail world, what are my metrics? What is the domain knowledge I have about seasonality of products? What is the stimulus data I'm collecting all the time, right? Point of sale. And then what is the state of a customer? What is the state of a store? What is the state of a website? What is the state of a product? Inventory and all of that. How do I define state for every entity in my domain? That is the key. And then how do I respond? And you know, based on the metrics I have, what can I do? Now, these two areas that we talked about have flourished because we are collecting a lot of sensor data. Now, if I look at agriculture, for example, why is that not flourishing? So if you look at agriculture, we know the metrics. We know that crop yield has to be high. We know that, you know, the health of the crop should be high and all of that. We have a tremendous amount of domain knowledge about this. But the reason why this is not working out is we don't have enough stimulus data, right? And if you don't have stimulus data, which is satellite data, soil IoT data, weather data, and the crop yield, right? What did you grow, what practice you did, and how was the, if you don't have that, we are not able to succeed in AI in agriculture, right? And the same problem is happening in education. We are not able to collect stimulus data, but every other part of education, we know how to do better. So those are the things we need to work on. So let me just summarize. So what are the core guiding principles that I have learned, right? So the first is AI is not installed. It improves over time, right? So we talked about that. Don't think of your data as the only data. There's a lot of public data that you can use to augment your data. Third is, you know, data science is actually not about data. It's really about your creative process of defining what is a state. Because if you define your state well, you know what to do when you convert this to this, and you know what to do when you go from state to action. Yeah? So state thinking is kind of the most critical thinking. Don't build models, build modeling platforms. That's one mistake a lot of data scientists, I will build a model and deploy. Well, the models have to be built every day. You are not going to do this. So model platform has to be built once you decide what models you want to do. Don't think of a collection of models, think of an ecosystem of models. How will they interact with each other? And you know, IT thinking is really about building products. And this is the most important insight, that AI thinking is about building a sensor. And if you make that transition, that your Paytm is not a product, it's a sensor. Ola is not a product, it's a sensor. Google search is not a product, it's a sensor. If you think like that, the whole, because the stimulus layer is better, and you're going to be able to do your product.